bags are an easy surface to create on and are available in a variety of sizes and styles. They can be a standalone project or created with the mindset of being added to something else, which can be a journal page, a card, canvas, wood panel, a scrapbook layout, mixed media project, or anything else that you can think of. In today's video, I'm working with the four styles of Studio Light Essentials tag blocks and using a variety of media and techniques on them. You'll find links to the products down below. There are four styles of tag blocks. There's Classic, this one is named Global, then we have Oriental, and the final one is Urban. So these are, the tags all measure the same size. They're approximately 2 7/8 by 5 7/8. The difference is the profile along the top where the hole is, and you can see that each of them reflects a different shape. The tags are 300 GSM and they're glue bound. So 300 GSM is roughly equivalent to 140 pound watercolor paper. When you want to take a tag out, it's pretty much as simple as that. Now, interestingly enough, these are slightly smaller than our number 8 tags, but what I found interesting about that was that they present some fun opportunities to layer things. You can either line these up so that the holes show, or you can move this down so that the top of the Studio Light tag covers up that hole, but you can see that the possibilities for exploring various things are pretty endless. So I've applied a variety of media to the tags and found everything was pretty much well accepted. When the Marabu Shimmer Art Crayons debuted, I want to say it was a week ago, I didn't have time to demo my dip and dab technique with them. So in the next segment, I'm going to do that on these tags so you can see how both of them work together. But first I want to show you where some of my ideas for color combinations from, and then I'll demo using paint. Let's put these over here. So there were two collage papers in the most recent Art by Marlene release, which was named Out of This World. I did use the black and white. In fact, you can see that there's a sample here. I did pull some of the color, some of the sheets out of the black and white and tore them up, and you can see that here. But what I really loved was the color combinations that were in the colored paper pad. Now, before I forget, we have a group of Art by Marlene products that we have enough quantity on that we've got them on sale at 35% off. Both of these happen to be fall into that category. All the rest of the Art by Marlene stuff is on sale at 20 off. So let's talk now about inspiration. I have three of the sheets of collage paper I pulled from that pad. Here's the first one, and then here are some tags, and there's one each. So there's white, black, and craft. Here are the tags that I made using those colors. Now, very obviously, there's no orange or yellow in here. I don't want to get into too many colors because for me, working on a tag this size, I felt like it would overwhelm things. All right, so there's that sample. Put that over there. Now, ordinarily, I do not use these colors. They're pretty close to primary, although there is some, you know, there are some secondary and tertiary colors in here, but these are brighter colors that are not my normal thing. With the exception of this one where I forgot to use the yellow for some reason, they all beautifully reflect what's on this piece of paper. And I gotta say, though I don't normally reach for these colors, I really, really like this group, whether this one has the yellow on it or not. So then the final inspiration came from this piece of collage paper. I adore this piece of collage paper. I love the colors in it. I love the fact that it's not super busy. The spattering on it, you can see, is evident in some places, but in others it really does blend in a little bit more. And here are the tags that I created using them, using these colors. So there's two white. Don't ask me how I ended up with two white, but I did. Then the craft and the black. Now you'll notice that the spattering on these two is much more evident because I used the darker color. You have to look to see it, but it is here. I used this Reflex color that is really just, that's what Royal Talons names their fluorescent colors. So I use that to spatter here and here, and it's a little bit less obvious, but sometimes it doesn't have to be completely in your face. So for the Shimmer crayons, this was the inspiration for these three also. Now, the colors are a little bit different because I grabbed three colors from the Shimmer crayons. I grabbed, where are we here? So I have, this is Shimmer Copper, Shimmer Rose Pink, and I think this is Shimmer Lilac. These pretty much reflect what goes on here, bar the addition of the copper, but I kind of like the way that that looks. So I'm going to use these colors in the next segment when I demo how to dip and dab with the art crayons. All right, but in the meantime, let's look at one other piece of inspiration. Let's put that over there. So from also the Shimmer Art Crayon video, I did this piece of dictionary paper. And if I hold this, you might just be able to see the shimmer on it. It's a little less evident on this paper. And these, where's the third one? What did I do with the third tag? Well, there's another tag here someplace that, it's this tag. So these three tags, this one, and this one, were all inspired by this piece of dictionary paper. You know, I always talk sometimes jokingly about the fact that my studio, or my table anyway, my bench is a mess, but there are advantages to not putting stuff away. And having things hanging around like this is certainly one of them. So when I come back to other inspiration, on this tag, it was this figure. This is from the Art by Marlene Out of This World paper elements block or die cut block. This dress was what inspired the rest of the colors on this tag. This is more of the collage paper. Okay, so let's come back. Let me figure out where I am here. Let's come back to this. And I have three tags and I've got some colors of Amsterdam acrylics. Let's find my tags. Here's my tags. Okay, so my colors are, this is permanent red violet light. This purple is called ultramarine violet. This is reflex rose, which is really, everybody else calls it fluorescent pink. We can call it reflex rose. And then this color is Prussian blue phthalo. So these are the three that I'm going to use. And then you'll notice, where is it? On this tag, and well, actually on all three of these tags, that there is shimmer on here. I did not use any of the metallics from this line. Instead, what I did for these was I brought in, this is a Sparks paint in the Finnabair line. It's named Mermaid Sparkle. For this combination, I'm going to use the one a little bit at the end that's named Butterfly Spells. Okay, so here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to use these four colors with the addition of the Butterfly Spells when I get to the very end. I'm going to push this here. You won't be able to see the whole thing, but there's only so much room for me to work in the frame. So on the black tag, I'm going to, what am I going to do here? I'm going to finger paint the color on here. On the white tag, I'm going to smush the colors, which is, good grief, I can't find anything at this point, which is what I did here. That's smushed. It'll make sense. And on the craft one, I'm going to do a combination of the three. Which order you start with is really kind of irrelevant, although I do like to leave the darker color for last. So let's grab the purple since I have it here. Now, if I'm going to combine a couple of techniques, I've got to give myself some room here to do that. So on the white, I'm going to smush the colors. On the black, I'm going to finger paint. I just want to keep track of what I'm doing here so I don't make a mistake. So when I finger paint like this, it's very straightforward, and I generally, unless I'm working with colors that I know will make mud, I generally do this in a way that I do it quickly enough that I can move from color to color to color. And, sorry, it's hard to do two things at once. Thinking and talking is not working for me. I move from color to color to color so that they're still wet. Let me grab a paper towel. They're still wet when it comes time for me to finger blend the next color on. All right, so I'm going to come in here and I'm going to, this is smushing. And that's how you get this kind of look. Now it's a little bit busier here. There's a little bit more paint just because there was a little bit more paint left over. All right, so let's get this out of the way. And then let's bring in the pink. This is the permanent red violet light. I'm going to use this next. And I'm going to put less of this paint out because it was really too much. And on this one, I'm going to smush the paint on here, which is my combination of the two. All right, so let's come in and put some color here. And again, I can get blending because, in fact, the purple paint is still wet. Now, nothing says you have to cover the entire background. There are plenty of great backgrounds that are, but there are just as many wonderful backgrounds where the background is not colored at all. All right, so let's, or not colored in its entirety, sorry. So let's go ahead and spread this out, wipe my finger off, and then I'm going to do a little bit of smushing here. Oh, I like that. That's pretty cool. So you can see I've got some coverage on top of the purple. And then here, I'm just going to do the same thing. Now, if you have paint left over, and I actually do this time, one of the things that you can do is really kind of, as that paint starts to dry on your nonstick craft sheet, you can rub it off and you can get some really interesting patterns that way. All right, so let's just clean this up a little bit. Next, I'm going to bring in the fluorescent pink, or Reflex Rose as it's named. Now, reflex or fluorescent colors have a tendency to be at least semi-transparent, so I'm not going to get super coverage here, and that's okay. That's the nice thing about having multiple styles of paint. You can do lots of different things with them. So on this one, let's just go ahead and finger paint some color on. I like to do horizontal and vertical lines. I find when I work on the diagonal, I'm not always as thrilled with the results. So that's kind of what you see me doing here. All right, so now what I'm gonna do, my goodness, there's paint everywhere. Now what I'm gonna do is come in and smoosh that around and get some of, oh, I like that. Get some of that on there. And then since there's a little bit left, let's see what happens if we just kind of smoosh this. All right, so then the final color is the really dark one. And this is the one that's named Ultramarine Blue Phthalo. Not going to need too much of that. Now, this is not going to show quite as much on the black unless I place it over one of the existing colors. So that's kind of what I'm doing here. Now, if you don't like the finger marks, you just need to keep blending and that will smooth them out. I actually do, so I kind of leave them there. Right, I think that's enough on there. So I think the remainder of this, I'm gonna do the smoosh. So we'll spread this out. I don't want thick globs of paint. It doesn't work as well that way. Wipe my finger. All right, so because this is dark, I wanna be careful how much I add. Oh, I like that. All right, that looks good. And for here, well, since it's all spread out, I'll go ahead and I'll smoosh here too. Okay, so let's make this easy and use a little bit of water just to clean that up. And then I'm going to bring in the butterfly spells. I'm not going to use it on all of them, but I am going to use it on the craft tag. So I'm just going to put a little teeny bit out. All right, grab a palette knife and just put a little tiny bit of this out. And that's probably more than enough. Let's get the crumblies out of the way. And go ahead and smoosh this around. And then bring the tag in. See, how awesome is that? You get some coverage, but you also get that wonderful shimmer. Okay, I can't help myself. I know there's a little bit left here, so I'm just going to see if I can get it. And there's a little teeny bit on there. So there's technically five colors here. There's these two techniques that, whether you keep them separate or you combine them, present some really interesting backgrounds. And I don't ever want, I mean, sprays are great, dip and dab is great, I use all of them a lot, but I wanted something a little bit different this time. I wanted some different backgrounds to work with than my typical, because I don't want to get stuck in a rut any more than you do. So up next, I'm going to show you my dip and dab technique with the Marabu Shimmer Art crayons. And remember, these are exclusively ours. These also are 35% off. And this is what's coming up next. I'm still working with this sheet of collage paper as my color inspiration. And as I mentioned a moment ago, the three colors of Marabu Art Shimmer Art crayons that I'm using are copper, lilac, and rose pink. Now, dip and dab means I'm going to have to add some water because these are not liquid, which is typically how I would work with a dip and dab technique. So the easiest way to accomplish this is by putting the colors down one at a time, adding some water, and then doing the dip and dab. So again, I have the three. I've got the black, the craft, and the white, and I'm going to start with, let's start with the pink because, well, why not? So I'm just going to scribble some color out here, and because I'm doing three tags, I'm going to put a fair amount of it down because I'm going to need enough to get it on all of them. If I have to come back, I of course can do that. So I'm going to take some water, and I'm going to, well, first I'm going to liquefy these crumbles too, but I'm going to liquefy what I scribbled out here on my nonstick craft sheet, and then I'm going to dip and dab. So I'm not going to try to get complete coverage on here because it would take too long. I could, but for the sake of just showing the technique, I want to be as brief as possible. So again, dip and dab is exactly what it sounds like. And I'm going to get color. Now, it's a little hard to see the shimmer, but I know that it works because I've previously done it. So you can just believe me when I tell you that the shimmer works. And, ooh, I like that. And I'll take photos of this anyway, and we'll have some photos of all of this stuff out on the blog. Well, excuse me, out on social media, and maybe I can get some in the newsletter on Friday. All right, so this is a little bit less obvious here, but again, it will appear at the very end, because of course the contrast in color to the background is going to affect how much of it you see. Alright, so let's do the copper next. Again, I'm going to scribble out a fair amount. Because the copper color is a little bit similar to the nonstick graph sheet, it's a little bit harder to see, but it'll be just fine. Again, I'm going to get my crumblies kind of blended in here. I'm just squishing it under my finger to try to soften that little piece of pigment and then get it to spread out and become liquidy. If it's not perfect, I don't care. It doesn't matter if it's not perfect. All right, I've got the craft one here, so let's come back with that. Now, obviously, this is a craft tag, so you're going to see the copper a little bit less on here, but again, once it dries, it's going to be a different kettle of fish. Come in with the white and do the same thing. Now I'm leaving some of the pink behind. That's because this is not dry in between. If I had dried them in between, that would be less of an issue, but I'm working with the same three colors on all the tags, so it really doesn't make a whole heck of a lot of difference. All right, that looks pretty good. And now we'll put down the purple. Alrighty, same thing, we'll add some water and then blend, squishing those crumblies. Okay. Now I'm not going to agitate these because I don't want the copper and the lilac to make a to muddy up. So I'm just going to be a little bit cautious about that. Again, if I had dried these, they would look completely different. Or at least there wouldn't be any risk of them blending. All right, so let's come in and dip and dab. Okay, so let's wipe this up. In 1 second, I'm going to show you how to finger blend these two for a background. But in the meantime, here are the three tags. Now again, visibility is going to be a little bit different once they're dry. So I'm going to put these to one side. I'm going to show you how to finger blend with the three colors of Shimmer Art Crayons. And then I will show you the results of these once they're dry at the beginning of the next segment. We'll slide these over here. Alright, so I'm going to use white because that happens to be the tag that's right in front of me. Again, the same three colors of Shimmer Art Crayons. Now the beautiful thing about these is how easy they are to blend, and I'm mimicking the same technique more or less that you saw me do with the finger painting, which is to work my colors up and down and side to side. Here, obviously, with the tag a different shape at the top, it's a little bit different. Come in now with some copper, and again, the Shimmer Art Crayons are dry to the touch and wipe resistant in about 24 hours. But what that means is that I can still come in and I can finger blend these colors together, and I think that that's nice. All right, so Now, you can see that I've used a lot of that crayon. It's a simple matter. This whole barrel is full of pigment. So you just, like a lipstick container, you just twist it to extend the color. All right, so now in with some purple. As with the dip and dab, nothing says you have to cover the entire background with color. You can, I did here. The backgrounds are pretty much, let's see if I can pull these in. The backgrounds are pretty much all Shimmer Art crayons, but for here I'm going to leave a little bit of white. Not a lot, but enough so that you can see that this was done on a white tag. And really, that's how simple it is. As I said, these will become wipe resistant in about 24 hours. So layers are a really important part of my work, and I'm going to guess yours too. Let me clean up, and then I'm going to come back and show you some more of the finished tags and some options for adding layers, and I'll show you that dried, the three tags that I did a moment ago with the dip and dab technique, that'll be dry. So here are the three tags that I used the Shimmer Art crayons with the dip and dab technique, and now that they're dry, you can really see, if I get the light to reflect in it, you can see the shimmer color in there, or the shimmer in the color there, and these are really nice. I like these. Sometimes, again, as I said in the last segment, I don't want all my stuff to look the same. So here's the ones finger blended. Here are examples that I did with the finger painting technique, and then the combination, and then adding a little bit of that Sparks Art Alchemy paint. None of these look the same, which is good because it gives me a nice variety of surfaces to work on once I'm ready to start adding the layers. And that's what I want to talk about next. So there are all different kinds of ways to add layers. For today, I'm concentrating on stamps and torn strips of either the Art by Marlene collage paper or dictionary pages. I'm not going to demo the torn paper, but you can see examples. Well, here's a piece that didn't get laid down properly. You can see examples on it on many of the tags that I made, and it's simply a matter of just tearing and arranging till you have something that pleases the eye, and then go ahead and glue them in place. So let's talk about stamping. I've used several different of the Art by Marlene sets, and again, these are ones that we have on sale at 35% off because we have so many of them in the warehouse, and we want to try to clear some space on the shelves. So this one is named Writings, and this is stamp 79. Where did I use this? Someplace here, there's a tag. You can see that I used this stamp on these pieces of collage paper. I'm going to use, is this the one? I'm going to use this heart in a second. We'll talk about that. So this is named Writing on the Wall. You can see there's still some green paint on here. It's important to clean, and I'll talk about that in a second. This was done with the Writing on the Wall, which is stamp 76. This is named Dramatic Dots. This is stamp BM70. Here you can see that I used that to do this. And then, where are we? This is the fourth of the one that I'm working with today that's named Love. It's stamp 80, and you can see that I used it here. So on dark surfaces, it's oftentimes a good idea to stamp with paint. Now, this is obviously not dark, but this is, because most ink from an ink pad, even if it's a pigment ink pad, is not strong enoughly opaque to really show on a dark background on something like this. So I'm going to stamp with paint. All right, let's get these out of the way. So I'm using, this is the heart I'm using from the Writings set. Stamping with paint is actually really easy. Now here, this was done with ink because there was enough background showing that I could see the stamp without worrying about losing it in the background. Okay, so I'm going to, if I could get my fingers to work, I'm going to work with the Prussian Blue Phthalo because it's a dark color, and though there is some of it on here, I think it's going to contrast nicely with the rest of what's on there. If it doesn't work, we'll try a different one. I've got my water bottle nearby. So when I do this, you can do this however you want, but when I do it, I just kind of spread it out like this, and I find it's easy to just tap the stamp into the paint to go ahead and ink it up. So here's my brand new stamp. I'm just going to tap. You can see the marks there, and there's the ink. Now I'm going to turn these facing all the same way. You certainly don't have to, but that's what I'm going to do. And I like it when some of them run off the edge like that. So let's kind of do that like that. Now, as I said a moment ago, it's really important that you clean this stamp. So I'm going to wipe the excess paint off. I'm going to clean this up. And I'm going to come in. You can do this one of two ways. You can spray directly on the stamp as I have. You can put it face down in a puddle of water. Whatever gets you to a clean stamp. Now, if there's a little bit of paint in the background, I don't really worry about that too much. And by the background, I mean these areas outside of the design area. I'm not too worried about that. But what I don't want to have happen is, and this is not a terribly detailed stamp, which you can see by looking here. And if you use a stamp that's too detailed, you're not going to see the details. Paint is not as well suited to stamping really detailed designs. It's just the nature of the beast. So what I want to do is make certain I have all this paint off, and I think I managed to add some because my paper towel is not super clean. You know, the nice thing about your tools is that some of them you can be a little bit laissez-faire about in terms of how you clean them, but something like a stamp with paint, you really need to be careful to care for them well. Otherwise, they won't care about you and they won't work the next time you want to use them. So the other thing to remember, oops, sorry. Talked about that. My brain is going in six different directions. So once you get the background done, and I could spatter this, that would add a little bit of interest if I wanted. I could even add collage paper to this if I wanted, or dictionary paper if I had, well, I do have something that matches, oddly enough. So if I grab just a little piece of this, if I wanted to come in and put a couple of pieces on here, I could certainly do that. A lot of times it's fun to put the collage paper on first and then stamp over the top, but by placing the paper on top of the stamp, it pushes those stamped images to the background. Okay, so once you're satisfied with the layers, and for the sake of argument, we're going to say that I'm satisfied with the layers on this tag, then it's time to think about a focal element, whether it's something from the Art by Marlene die-cut blocks that I'm going to bring in a second, or a stamp that you love that you color and cut out. A focal image is a focal image. So for example, on this tag, she's my focal image. She was also the driving force behind the other colors on here, but she is my focal image. So for all the things that I've worked on today, I've used either elements from the Out of This World block, or these are two. This is from, I think, Marlene's collection number five. These are die cut blocks BM05 and 06. All three of these are on sale at 35% off because, again, the shelves are groaning with them. So when you get your focal element on there, one of the last things I tend to do is add some writing or some lines or some doodles or something with ink. I just think that it makes things a little bit more interesting. So here I used either a Posca paint pen, or I used the Uni white pen to come in and add some dash marks, some circles. Now you all know that I am not much of a card maker, but with one piece of the black and white collage paper that I spattered some speckled egg distress spray oxide on, one tag and one element. Now I haven't put a sentiment on here because I don't know what I'm going to do with the card in terms of who it's for or what the occasion is, but if I can do this and I'm not a card maker, then you absolutely can do this. So, but you can see that all of these things, the line work, the dots, the circles, the scribbles, all of those things go into making a really interesting finished tag. Whether you use it on a journal page, on a card, as a standalone piece, I mean, the sky really is the limit with these. So these are the Studio Light Essential Tag Blocks. They're available in four sizes, and they're ready to head to your studio to play along.